Sue Grant. You don't have enough jobs to do.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I forgot that we were doing welcome today. So welcome. If you would stand as we prepare to worship this morning. We weren't quite prepared to do indoor service again. We've been so used to being outside, and it's been nice, but we didn't have an umbrella big enough for later. So we always need those good reminders that God is good through all situations. I'm going to make sure I'm in tune real quick, and then we're going to worship together.
No pressure or anything.
Good opportunity to know that we need extra help or more help around here. We're back on the sound booth.
Yeah, if anyone is interested in volunteering in any way, let us know. And let's worship and just remember how awesome our Lord really is.
of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for the sake he came for. So here I am to worship. To see my sin upon that cross, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. To say that you're my God, you're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
During this next song, I always call this the altar song. When I first joined Shoreline 7 years ago, that was one thing that really struck me about this. I'd never seen that in a church before. So we always have at least one song where we invite you to come up to the altar. And my favorite part about that is that people from the church, whether they know you or not, will surround you and they will pray with you and they will pray for you. So during this next song, if you're comfortable, you can come up to the altar. If you're not, but you still want prayer, feel free to raise your hand and somebody will pray with you.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a
recognize that and feel your presence, and that above all else that you would be our desire, that would overshadow everything. And just bless our time together, and thank you for the words that you've given to Pastor Bill to share with us this morning, and speak through him this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, that's better. good morning, everyone. Today's reading is from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings, and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved.
We want to give special thanks to the worship team. It is weird being back in here. All of a sudden, you got to move things. There's more technical things. There's a PowerPoint. You got to figure out what cord goes into what plug back there. And they've done a masterful job working through that. And I think Grant's probably got a workout in today, running, just with all the setup. So because when it's out there, there's nothing up here. You may not think, oh, what's the big deal with that? But then getting everything right can be a challenge sometimes. So what'd you think about the debate? At the end of it, I was kind of disappointed and just kind of sick to my stomach. Just, and I guess I expected more out of both of them. And the performance left me kind of just depressed over the leadership of our country. Now, I want you to catch, I still have hope, okay? God's still working on me. He's still working on everybody, so it's not everybody can have those times. But I still have hope, definitely, for our country. Good people. It was interesting to read, though, the different people who commented almost immediately after that, how people, so many people condemned Trump and Biden for their behavior. While in their reporting, they were more crass than Biden or Trump. Just how they did it. Just showed no class. And I think the debate and the response to the debate gives us a kind of a glimpse of people's emotional state now. I think people are angry. I think people are divided in a lot of different ways. They are depressed. There's a loneliness. And there's confusion. You know, what do you do? The best quote, in my opinion, on the debate came from Kurt Franklin. If you ever saw him lead worship, the guy is a little bit enthusiastic. I appreciate him. He's a recording artist. He said this about the debate. The country lost tonight. The country lost tonight. And again, I think that's just a reflection of how 2020 has taken our world and turned it upside down and made it absolutely clear that our world needs Jesus and the church at its best. The world needs Jesus and the church at its best. Over the coming weeks, we're going to be looking at the idea at the first church in Acts chapter 2 and begin to look at that church. Now, it was an imperfect church. If you're looking for a perfect church, then don't go to it, because when you get there, you'll make it imperfect. I would do the same thing. We're all imperfect. But the point is, they were imperfect, but man, they were an incredible example of really what a church should be about. So we'll be looking at that. As together we look at resetting Shoreline back to a much better than normal. I hate that, back to normal. Much better than normal. The early church gives us a template of the attitudes and the thoughts and the actions that the early church modeled. It is a great template for us to look to. See, we're all on a journey. We're in this journey together. We're also kind of by ourselves somewhat, pursuing with God. And while our faith is supposed to be personal, it's also not. It was never meant to be private. It's a body life thing. Healthy, life-giving relationships are where real life change begins and discipleship begins. That's really where things happen. There's some good things that can happen here, no question. This is part of the strategy, part of together coming and celebrating what God does. But boy, when I look at my life, the biggest steps that have happened for me and the biggest steps of growth have happened through those relationships where someone sharpens me and challenges me and encourages me. So we all need this group of friends who can push us, who can comfort us, who can encourage us, and kind of just do life with together. The question this morning is, do you have a group of friends who consistently push, encourage, and comfort you in your journey with Christ? Or you can be real honest. You can say, I don't know, I'm mad, or I'm whatever, I don't understand why this happens. Do you have those friends who are taking that journey with you? For me, part of my group is some guys I meet with. I think the navigators and the pastors I meet with are the ones who really give me that community. We can be very blunt. I was very honest with the guys this last week. I said, this has been a really crappy week. They just, here's why, you know. And it gives me that avenue to share that and be just totally honest. Same with the group of guys I meet with. We've met together now for almost 10 years. And so there's really no holes barred within that group, you know. And we ask each other good questions and encourage each other. We communicate throughout the month. And I can honestly say that I would not be here today without those ongoing relationships. I wouldn't be. I'd have chucked it. And sometimes we feel that way in our own lives of Christ. We feel like we just want to chuck things sometimes because we just can't understand it and we're frustrated. But we need those relationships, those ongoing relationships, if we're going to make an impact. Today what we want to look at is, again, those spiritual disciplines that were practiced by the people of the early church that enabled that early church there in Acts chapter 2 to establish this community that those outside the church wanted, that they desired, that they admired. So let's look at the idea of really rediscovering community. Those who are at home, I don't know why I'm looking here. We're outside the mic, the camera's right there. Those at home up there, I'm sorry. Those at home, now I'm confused, which is surprising to you. Okay. Now, those at home and those who are on campus, open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. If you don't have, in here we don't have Bibles available because of COVID, so you can either look on your phone, you also look at the message notes. I typed them out there. Also, be sure when you came in, if you did not grab some communion elements, there's a little red table back there by the fire extinguisher, feel free to get those. And those of you at home now can run around and go like, oh yeah, they're doing that today. And so go ahead and get those elements. We'll be doing taking communion in the message this morning, in the message. While you're turning the text, let's define what spiritual discipline is. Discipline's not a very good word for people. We don't tend to think positive. But spiritual disciplines are those practices that are found in Scripture that promote spiritual growth. Those practices in Scripture that promote spiritual growth in the followers of Christ. And as you look at them, they're to be practiced both as individuals, but also as a group, as a unit, as a body. For example, we're all supposed to read our Bibles. We all get to read our Bibles and see what God has to say and dig into that. But we also do that as a church. It's corporate, as a body. It's also individual. So I want you to see both these go both ways. We tend to put them in one box. It's all one box, okay? Not separate boxes. Spiritual disciplines are actions that we take and that we repeat over and over again to develop. There's one gentleman I read, Dr. Don Whitley, a professor, said this about the disciplines. He said, spiritual disciplines are the means and not the end. Spiritual disciplines, the things we're going to talk about today, are the means, not the end. The end, that is, the purpose of practicing the disciplines, is to become more like Jesus. So the things, the disciplines we do, lead us to that end. They're not really the goal. They're a way to get to that end. So whether it's maybe it's I've only been in one play, okay, and I did poorly at it. But if you're in a play, I'm sure you practice things. But really what you're working toward is when you get to when you get there to perform, that it's ready to be done well. So all those things are a means to an end. And that's what the spiritual disciplines are. And as we look at the idea, we talk a lot here about representing Jesus well. The way that happens is through those disciplines. Let's look at verse 4. We're going to walk through the text this morning. We'll read verse 4. Acts chapter 2. I'll get there myself. Acts chapter 2. And we'll start verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. So the first thing we need to think through is, who are the they? Well, the they are that we just saw from last week. That's those 3,000 who responded to Peter's message, responded to the guys who were different people that were sharing really the gospel in different languages so people could understand them from all around the world. It's that 3,000 plus that 120 or so that were gathered in Jerusalem. That's the they and there. Now, as we look at that, what did they do? Well, they devoted themselves to the teaching of God's word, the apostles' teaching. Today we have God's word there. They would have had that. But the apostles' teaching. And where they got the teaching, it was interesting. They got the teaching still in the temple. They went to the temple and the courts. They would meet in the courts, and they also met in homes. And as a church, they steadfastly stuck to God's word as absolute truth and didn't compromise God's word to please their culture. And this speaks to us today also. This church saw and kept God's word as their foundation for life. That's why they were so desperate to get into it. During the times when they gathered, they made times for reading and applying God's word a priority. It wasn't just about hearing it. It was about applying it. They didn't just talk about the Bible or tell a story about the Bible. They dug into the Bible itself. And they could do it really well because of memorization. They were really much better than I am, than we are. It's interesting, in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6, it says this as he speaks to pastors. He says, if you instruct the brethren in these things, referring to Scripture, you'll be a good minister in Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you've carefully followed. So it's important as a church that we get into God's Word. That's part of the reason why I encourage you to always either have a Bible with you or get on your phone, which is a great tool, or I write it out. I want us to actually see the Scriptures, not talk about the Scriptures. Okay? So to devote themselves to the apostles' teaching. Also, they are also committed as individuals. As individuals of that first church, they dug in and memorized portions of Scripture and the sermons. And they got him into them personally, and they also got him into a small group. So it says they met in the homes, okay? And that's why I give you a talk sheet. I don't give you a talk sheet because you're going like, oh, my word. I come to church and they're giving me homework, you know, that horrible feeling. Get flashbacks to school. No, that's there simply as a tool to help you dig more in Scripture for yourself or as you get home as a family or as a group to talk through those things and dig more into them. 1 Peter 2:2 says this, like newborn babes, crave pure spiritual milk. So that by it you may grow up in your salvation. But we should be as desirous of God's word as this beautiful little baby here is, probably being fed. When they want to get fed, at least my granddaughter, she lets us know. And that should be that desire. And Romans 12:2 says this, don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve God's will, his good, pleasing and perfect will. Let's take that apart just real quick to see the importance of God's word. It says, don't conform to the pattern of this world. How do you not conform to what the world does? You conform to what the Bible says. That's your focus. If you're always sweating not to do what the world does, you're going to eventually cave. You look at what Scripture says and you focus on that, not this other stuff. Does that make sense? So we conform to the pattern of the Scripture. It says you're transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know how your mind is changed? When you're into Scripture, either together or as a group, and you begin to understand how God thinks, and then it transforms your mind to think like God would think. We begin to see his will. It begins to become more just almost like we just know it because we've been in the Scripture long enough. So we are to be devoted to God's word, to know it and to keep it as our compass of life. Even when it's hard to do, especially when it's hard to do. So spiritual discipline, number one, is devote yourself to the, real easy now because you can see it on the, this is horrible. Forget it. You can read it. Teaching God's word. I'm not used to having that thing anymore. We've been outside. I haven't used one of those for a long time. Discipline number two, devote yourself to fellowship. Fellowship. Let's look through here and see what does Scripture say about fellowship. Well, the Greek word is koinonia. I don't use a lot of Greek but it's just a great, great word. It just flows. Koinonia. And you've probably heard that phrase. But you probably don't know what it means. What it means is to be partners with or to share with. To be partners, to be connected with somebody else, and to share with. And what happens, what's amazing to me, the amazing thing that happens when somebody becomes a Christian is at that point, there's a transformation that happens that unites us together in partnership with other Christians around our Savior and around our purpose of loving God, loving people, and making disciples. As incredible as salvation is, that's awesome, that transformation, but there's also the idea that then we're united together in fellowship. That's what that means. Fellowship is what we do together because we're the family of Christ. Together we're a part of the body of Christ, and none of us can function to our potential without being connected to the body. I know you've heard that all your lives, but think about it. If for some group, one of my friends, he's out in Wyoming now, Richard, this is like 20 years ago. One of his hands, his right hand, is missing two fingers. He's not so good at the saw. Okay, and he laughs about it. Hey, how you doing? You know, and he always laughs, and he's good about that. But can you imagine? We cannot function in the body of Christ unless we're connected to it any more than one of Richard's fingers can function when it's laying on the ground. It can't. It just never will. And it's true about you and about me. We cannot function outside of being connected to the body. Richard Smith, there we go. Okay, Richard Smith. You're called to belong, not just believe. We're created for community. We're fashioned for fellowship. We're formed for a family. And none of us can achieve God's purpose without somebody else, without ourselves, without other people. It's a team sport. Rick Warren, really good book. If you've never read it, you should. It's from a long time ago, but it's just still probably one of the best books written, The Purpose-Driven Life. He describes fellowship this way. He says, the Bible knows nothing of solitary saints or spiritual hermits, isolated from other believers and deprived of fellowship. You are not your own anymore. While your relationship with Christ is personal, God never intended for that to be private. In God's family, you're connected to every other believer, and we'll belong to each other for eternity. So as we look at this next discipline, is the idea we need to be devoted to each other, as together we seek to represent Jesus well as a person, but also as a church. I won't review because all the slides are up there. I'll get used to it again. Number three, devote yourself to the breaking of bread. Devote yourself to the breaking of bread. So what does that mean? What does that practically mean? And there's some different views, and this is what I see it to mean. First of all, I think as you look at the context, you look at verses all the way 42 to 47, they regularly shared meals and sought to meet each other's needs. That was a very brilliant church. When they saw their need, they sold some of their own stuff sometimes, and then they would take care of each other. They met together for meals. And I know it's difficult to share meals in COVID-19. That stinks. You can kind of do it, but it's just more difficult to do. But there's something about sitting down and sharing a meal together. Barbara Coloroso, I love that name, Coloroso, said this about meals. There's something profoundly satisfying about sharing a meal. Eating together, breaking bread together, is one of the oldest and more fundamentally unifying of all human experiences. And it's true. Something about just, you know, eating French toast and my eggs, you know, and those things together. There's something about that that really begins to bind people. So that's part of what it means to break into the bread. Okay, sharing meals together and just being together. The other part of it is the idea of communion, the Lord's Supper. John MacArthur, talking about this, said about the breaking of bread, gathering together to celebrate the Lord's Supper or communion is not an option. Now we don't celebrate communion every week. There's nothing wrong if churches do that. That's a great idea. For us, and that may change, but for us, I just don't want us to ever get so familiar with it, we forget what it means. So we try to practice and do that once a month. It's really not an option not to do communion. In communion, all believers, I love this. In communion, all believers meet on common ground at the foot of the cross. We all meet on common ground. It doesn't matter what our age we are. It doesn't matter our backgrounds. All that other stuff the world uses, we all come on common ground at the cross. Since we're all sinners saved by the grace of Christ. Communion, what it does is, when you're taking communion, you acknowledge the work that the Lord Jesus did on the cross to save our sins. And communion also symbolizes the unity of believers, since we all partake symbolically of the same Lord. And what's amazing is the communion has been celebrated and practiced over 2,000 years as a way of remembering Jesus' sacrifice of his body and blood for the forgiveness of sin. 2,000 years. And I know some parts of our world, it's not Sunday. So, but on Sundays across the world, you know, right now it isn't, but across the world on a Sunday, and there could be millions of people, millions of Christians taking communion together. And we're all one. That's amazing to me. Taking communion helps us to unite us and reminding us of the grace that we all share. And then this practice challenges us to start, be sure we stay in a good relationship with each other and with God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul gave some instructions about communion. And here's what he said. He said, "For what I received from the Lord, I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he gave him thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this as remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment upon themselves." Here at Shoreline, we practice something called open communion. And what that means is you don't have to be a part. I don't have to be a partner. We call them partners here instead of members. Partners with Shoreline Church, you don't have to be. Okay? That's an unbiblical stance. Hey, if you're not a member of this denomination, of this church, and you can't take communion, that's unbiblical. But we do need to be part of the body of Christ to take communion. And there are some things we need to do before we take communion, some ways we examine ourselves. In a moment, I'll flip to the next slide. It'll be the same slide for you, but I'll have some music on it. And on that music, during that music, that's your time to kind of walk through these steps as you prepare your heart for communion. First of all, you need to prayerfully consider what communion represents and all that he's done for you. Second, you ask God if there's any unconfessed sin between you and him. And if so, confess it to God and get right with him. Third, if you have any unresolved relationships with another Christian, do all you can to get right with God and others. So if there's something, if you're upset with somebody else, another Christian, and you've not done anything to work that out, then that's sin. You need to work that out first. Now, if you've done everything you can do to work it out and done all you can do, then that's good. That's all you can do. Then feel free to take communion. Also, if you're not right with God, I mean, you're just going like, you know, you want to continue in sin in some place, then you probably shouldn't take communion. Okay? Because you're taking that in an unworthy manner. If you're not a Christian here today or you want to pass on taking communion, that's fine too. There's been times I've passed on taking communion. And no one will look down on you at all. So over this next bit of time, as we have some music, I invite you to kind of prepare your hearts, just spend some time with Jesus, and begin to prepare to take communion.
Faithful Lord, we remember you. us to worship. And as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you.
Jesus said, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of him." And Jesus took the cup. He said, "This cup represents a new covenant in my blood. And each time you drink this, till I return or you return to me, drink this in remembrance of me." Take and drink. Okay. Now, we'll review what we've covered so far. And if we're indoor next week, we just each week, and if those of you are new with us, you can see Sarah, we raise your hand back there. She can hook you up, or Tracy here, raise your hand. You can get on Remind Me so he can let you know if we're outside or indoors on Sunday morning. And if it's indoors, it's usually out front. We'll be outdoors as long as we can, and then we'll start gathering back in here after that. First year spiritual discipline. Devote yourself to the teaching of. Okay, to the teaching of God's right. I gave it to you. Okay, that's right. Okay. Devote yourself to. No, the second one. You got that one. Bring it on, okay? You want to talk Bible trash, church trash here? We'll go here. To what? Fellowship, okay? And the third one, devote yourself to the breaking of bread, okay? Number four, talk trash to me, Lisa Burrow. Okay. Don't know who you're messing with. They devoted themselves to prayer. Devoted themselves to prayer. And you can see that throughout the book of Acts. And this church was really committed. They understood that Jesus was their only hope, and so they were united together in their dependence upon their trust in Jesus. I think that's what drove their prayer. They understood that we got no hope unless Jesus moves, unless the Spirit moves. Peter's in jail. What do? They pray. They don't have any control over that. And they caught that. That drove them to prayer. And as they saw the Spirit move, that fueled their prayers. They gave them more of a desire to get together to pray because they saw what God did. That's part of the reason, and we haven't had an opportunity to do it because we're outside, and you can't do it very well outside because of miking people. But that's one reason we have God sightings, where you share God sightings. One is it allows you to encourage other people, but I think it's important for somebody else who's wrestling with life to hear God does answer prayer from somebody else and not from the pastor. You expect me to say that, okay? But that's why we do the God sightings. They were devoted to both praying together as a church, but also in homes, and you see them also praying personally. Prayer is not just a religious practice and a service, part of the service order. It's not just that. Prayer is a tangible sign of your dependence and love for Jesus. Prayer is a tangible sign of your dependence and your love for Jesus. And friends, you know, when we consider the last presidential debate, there's no doubt that prayer is our hope. There's no doubt. Dependence upon God should motivate us to pray together. It's interesting, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and I think I listed the address on the notes, chapter 5, verses 16 through 18, it says this. It says, be careful no matter what, to pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. And the last part is what most people don't look at. This is the way God wants you who belong to Christ Jesus to live. How should we live? We need to act in our life and act upon the fact that God's got this. We need to trust that God's got this, no matter how much it seems to be falling apart. We should pray all the time. That doesn't mean, you know, you're always on your knees. I dare you to try to, when you go home today, get in your car and try to drive on your knees. I thought about how stupid that would look. I almost tried it, but it would kill my back. But it'd be stupid. And that's not what it's saying. What it means is you have an attitude of prayer all day long. You're connected with God, and if something comes up, God help me to do this, and you're praying. It's an attitude that you do all day long. It says, thank God no matter what happens. That just simply means is that we thank God because he's going to work out no matter what the situation is for our best in the long run. I don't understand how that works out, and there's some things I'm not going to understand what's best for me until I get to heaven. I don't understand why some things have happened. And probably you don't either. But Scripture still says it works out for our best. That's what he's telling us in that text. One of the best guys who writes on prayers, E.M. Bounds, and he said this. He said, prayer should not be regarded as a duty which must be performed, but rather a privilege to be enjoyed, a rare delight that is always revealing some new beauty. And it's true. You know, our first church-wide opportunity for prayer and praise will be Saturday, October 24th, 6 p.m. You'll see stuff on our Facebook page about this. The worship team came up, or I'm not sure who this. We planned it to start in March, but then March hit, so we're gonna start now. But it's called Sold Out, and the worship team will be predominantly leading it. I might do a little bit of it. I might not. I mean, there's going to be time of praying as well as singing songs and praise. And I'll be at 6 o'clock on the 24th. So, again, I encourage you not to miss that because it's important for us to pray as a body. So let's consider these four options. Now, what are some of the thoughts? Group participation, and this mic will pick you up, so those of you at home can hear this, and you can talk about this at home. What are some of the thoughts that come to your mind when I say the word discipline? When I say the word discipline. Work. What else? Punishment. Yeah, I think of the long end, the very end of a willow tree that you cut off and give to your mom. Ooh, and willow switches are the worst. But you can run from them. You're faster than your mom most of the time. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it was. But yeah, I think discipline, you think about, you know, extra sprints at a practice. We tend not to think positive when we hear the word discipline. But understand, God's definition of discipline is positive. God sees discipline as what he does for us, not to us. God sees discipline as what he does for us, not to us. And great athletes have, if you see, as you watch football this afternoon, possibly, great athletes are creatures of habit. They discipline themselves to do the same things over and over again. And the ones that are really good at it are the ones who sees workouts as an opportunity to improve. In the same way, these four spiritual disciplines we talked about today should not be seen as obligations, but they're opportunities for you to grow. And think about in team sports. In team sports or anything you do as a team, practices allow the older players, through their own example, to teach younger players how to excel at the game. In the same way, spiritual disciplines are best modeled and developed in a group. They're not best modeled and developed in this context. In fact, I don't think they're not really, well, they can be a little bit, I guess, in a Sunday morning. But I want you to see it's important. It's a team sport. Spiritual discipline number one, devote yourself to the of. Thank you. Number two, devote yourself to. Okay, that's not too bad. Devote yourself to the. And devote yourself to. Okay. Which, as we look at these four disciplines, we want to look through personal application here. I want you to think, which one has the Holy Spirit developed in your well in your life? What's the one that kind of stands out that God, he's really developed in your life well? I'll encourage you this week to spend some time thanking God for that. That discipline didn't come there by accident. So thank God for developing that discipline in your life. The second question is, what is the discipline that the Holy Spirit wants to improve? What's the one he wants to improve? You probably won't work on all four at the same time. You can try, but usually at one at a time. And I encourage you, again, find some other Christian you can join with to help develop that growth. So we'll be spending some more time on the disciplines. We'll talk more about that here in the future. But I want you to think through those questions as we think through application, okay? Make sense, what I'm asking? Okay. Please be standing. At this point, when I take our offering, it's our opportunity to worship God by giving back to him a little bit of what he's given to us. For those of you who are off campus, you can give several ways online. One through through our website, as well as through the app, the Shoreline app that you can receive. Also, if you're here, feel free. You can also give by way of cash or check, going by way dropping off during the week or putting it there in the box in the back of the building this morning. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for this opportunity to gather and look into your word and think through the things that you want to develop in us, the things that you want to develop in our church. And Father, I ask you to guide and direct along those lines. I ask that your Holy Spirit would lay on each of our hearts one that you've really developed that we can celebrate and say, yeah, boy, I'm seeing growth in that. And then, Father, you'd point out one that we need to work on next that we can celebrate later on when we see it developed. Father, we also pray today as directed by, or invited to, at least invited by our governor, just to pray for those who are going through COVID and our president. Father, we pray right now for those who are working through that. Because you never really know what it will be like. Will it be a bad one? Will it be good? Will it be serious? Will it be just light? And so for anyone who has COVID, it's always serious because you never know what can happen. So, Father, I ask you to be with those families, that you would give them peace, that you would give them comfort, that you'd be with those who are in beds, hospital beds, and working through those, being treated, that they would sense your hand, that they would sense your presence, that you would bring people into their path that reflect you well, and you would give peace. And then for our president and his wife, and sounds like several other members of the cabinet, Father, I ask that you would just move in their lives, and in the same way, bring those people across their path who can be Jesus with skin on, who can love on them and comfort them. And Father, I ask them just to lean into you in this time, that it would develop them. So God, thank you for this privilege you gathered today. And we just love you, Jesus. Amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. The earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
no one was meant to go through life alone. We're all wired for community. That's just part of how we're wired. We are all on this journey with God, and while our faith is supposed to be personal, it was never meant to be private. Healthy, life-giving relationships is really where real life begins and discipleship happens. We all need friends who can push us, comfort us, and encourage us in that process of becoming more like Jesus. And over the coming weeks, we'll be looking at the idea of sharing with you some old and then some new opportunities for you to experience that community. I want you to catch this morning. You know, I believe that God has some great things in store for our church, great things in store for our country. And we're not, as a church, we're not going to sit around and wait till things get back to normal, because it's just not a good move. It just doesn't make sense. We're going to try new things. We may fail at some things. We'll try some things. We're going to try stuff that we've never done before. Why? Because that, you know, we're going to move on to what God wants us to be. So I'd encourage you, remember from last week, keep working on the adventure. That's a little card that I handed out. You got them again this week. Gather somebody else, gather somebody else, and talk to each other about that, and pray through that throughout the week. Seek to represent Jesus as a person. And then, Father, as we gather back next week, we can celebrate those. This week, give God your best for his glory. You're dismissed.